Diaries of a Madman. Written by What Must I Do? Chapter 3. Just Say No. Part 2. I did, in fact, mind Heights, but I'd be fucked before I let her know that. I just grit my teeth and hung on for dear life, trying not to imagine myself as the first and only human to have become a pancake in a pony land. After a while flying, I shouted up at her, "If you drop me, I'll drag myself out of whatever afterlife I landed and haunt you. I don't imagine your house is ghost-proof."
"So I just have to make sure the drop doesn't kill you."
I didn't much like the sound of that. Long story short, after several faked false drops, I found out it was, in fact, possible for a human to be in her house. A very, very small part of her house. Feeling around the base of the room, I was trapped to reveal that most of it was immaterial. I immediately took a dislike to the tiny area that was in one of her closets. "So, you have me trapped here," I said, sitting on a small platform. "Now what?"
"I could just let you stew for a few days. You know, the spell I asked Twilight to cast here should last at least that long."
"Should is the key word there. You may be a bit rash, but you're no murderer. You brought me here for a purpose, one that could very likely have been taken care of on the ground in a more mundane discussion."
"Yeah, I probably could have kept you on the ground for that, but then there'd be no guarantees you'd tell the truth down there."
"Just as you have no guarantees I'll tell you any kind of truth up here, of course. I'm assuming that you want to know more about the test we ran with you. There were a very small number of witnesses, and they'll all agree with what I say and what I told you after we conducted it."
"There was this teensy, tiny thing you might have said that I want clarification on. I think you know what I'm talking about."
"Might have said. You kidnapped me for something I might have said. I have a problem with that."
"I'm sure you'll get over it. Now, I'll ask again, what happened that night?"
"Again, you never asked in the first place. I just guessed correctly that you were going to ask about it, and told you my piece before you said anything. But since I can see that you are considering pushing me to see what happens, I will tell you. Applejack and I ran a few experiments. You gave us information. As it turns out, Applejack was more into the prank side of the equation than the scientific side, but I'm still pleased with the results."
"Funny. She said the opposite was true of you."
I shrugged at that.
"Whatever. Tell me more about the tests."
"You tried to fly despite what we told you, which was very amusing. We also tested your mental process, which was also very amusing." I could tell she wanted more, but I knew I could outwit her. Dash did not seem to be all the patient sort, given how quickly she turned around to snatching me off the ground. Sure enough, she impatiently asked,
"And?"
"And did what?" "That's pretty much all we did."
"You're not telling me what I want to know."
"No, you're not telling me what you want to hear. There's a very big difference." "I shouldn't have been trying this discussion with a woman, should I?"
"Maybe I will leave you up here for a few days. I bet some time spent with your head in the clouds will put something more in your stupid logical mind of yours."
"Stupid, logical, pick one." "There is plenty enough emotion in my mind. I just choose not to show it when explaining experimental procedure. Trust me when I say that if I wanted to take the lid off, I would have rather quickly inundate you with anger. However, that would be a bit of a bad idea, as you have kidnapped me here and the only person that knows I'm up here. It would be satisfying for a short while."
You really aren't a pony. That's for sure. So, that's all that happened? Just tests? No flirting with Big Macintosh?"
"As far as I know, you didn't do any flirting with Big Macintosh. Doesn't mean he didn't try any flirting on you, though."
"As far as you know, that's comforting,"
she harumphed.
"But I really wasn't planning on keeping you here that long. I'm sure Twilight would say something if her new favorite study buddy disappeared."
With that, she wrapped her forelegs around me and took off. It was an interesting feeling, flying like that. I wasn't paying much attention before, thinking she'd still want revenge for some kind. But this time, though, I tried paying a lot more attention. So it was a lot more surprising when we passed over a lake and she dropped me. My reflexes woke up this time and pulled overtime as I managed to grab onto one of her legs as she was sailing away snickering, and I somehow pulled myself up onto her back. No, I don't know how. I really wasn't paying attention at the time. That was a mistake. I rode a few horses and even a cow or two when I was a lot younger before I developed. Those encounters did nothing at all to prepare me for a wild bucking flying mare that was doing her utmost to remove the indignity from her proud back. I held on for dear life as she did her best to remove me. Everyone at the rodeo would be cheering for me, even though I didn't handicap myself with one hand in the air. Both were wrapped around her neck, trying to make sure I didn't fall off as she did everything she could to dislodge me. Finally, as we're both getting completely exhausted, I tried reasoning with her. "You could just set me down!" I was very surprised when she suddenly seemed to click on and say,
That's not a bad idea.
So it was that we found ourselves with both of my feet and all four of hers planted firmly on the ground. We both said something at the same time that painted a completely different picture. Never again, and that was awesome. Guess who said what?
I never knew you humans could do that,
Rainbow Dash shouted. I didn't know I could either. Remind me to never ride you again. God, I'm gonna be feeling this for weeks.
What do you mean, never do that again? Well, how else are you gonna help me train for the Sky Rodeo?
If the Sky Rodeo is a real thing, and God, I hope it's not, why on earth would you want me to help you train for it? I'm the only human here.
It's not a real thing yet. But just think, you're the only human here, right? If we have to take some kind of competition that among Pegasi to see who can knock you off the fastest, it could be a huge spectacle sport. We could get Wonderbolt here and they could all see me in all my glory, showing every pony who's the best in yet another sport.
I see a few glaring flaws in your plan. First, as soon as I got bucked off, I'd go falling into the ground and crack my fucking skull. Second, since I'm the only human, I'd get more and more tired as the event goes on, making it harder for me to keep up. Third, despite what you may think, I'm actually a bit terrified of heights. I don't think I'm a Fluttershy's level of fear, but there's a reason I reacted so quickly when you tried to drop me.
As many flyers as we'll have up there, you won't have to worry about falling more than a few meters. You'll be caught almost instantly by some pony, and we can easily have Twilight find a spell that completely revitalizes you. And surely you can get over a small bit of fear in order to help me succeed with my dream. Think about it as a way to make up for that splitting headache you gave me.
How do I keep getting roped into this crap? I sighed. If, and I stress the if, I manage to get enough Pegasi interested, I'm in. But if I die, I will haunt you, and it won't be a pleasant haunting. There will be a lot of very, very scary things in my world that I haven't mentioned to anyone here, and my imagination is vast. Besides,
you won't regret it.
With that, she flew off, and I knew almost immediately that I would likely regret it. Hopefully, I'd at least live long enough to regret it. And not like I wanted kids anyway. After a rodeo, I'll probably never have them for sure. I sighed and tried to get my bearings. In the waning light, it was a bit difficult, and soon enough, I found myself I wasn't that far from the town, and I could probably get back to Rarity Shop before nightfall. Though, honestly, why she'd even want to know if Applejack could watch the kids before they needed it was beyond me. When I finally made it back to Twilight's library, the last bit of sunlight had faded, and it felt like the moon was watching me as I opened the door and made my way inside. Twilight and Spike were already in bed, so I had no time to waste with idle pleasantries. I happily sighed and went to find a place to rest my weary and battered body. When I finally sat down, but thankfully, before I could get comfortable, I heard a sound of someone gently rapping at my door. Hoping it was Rainbow Dash to tell me she had a change of heart, I made my way to the door. Instead, it was someone decidedly more raven-like. Luna. Look, I know I made an offer to the poor girl to come and talk any time, but really? She obviously didn't have any other friends, and if she came to talk to me two nights in a row, I reached over to grab my coat and joined her outside. You'll have to excuse me if I walk a bit slowly and stiffly, I told her. I'm battered and bruised from two encounters with over-enthusiastic torturers today.
Thout what accosted?
She boomed, forgetting both her inside voice and to speak properly. No, nothing like that. It was a joke, Luna. Jesus, I really need to teach her social cues or something. I just had a run-in with some people, and I did a lot more stuff than I'm used to. My body's aching because of it.
I see. I am still somewhat unused to this time's, humor. I assume there was a story behind your interesting day.
Yeah, I can't promise it's interesting, though. There are three fillies here that are looking to score their cutie marks. Their curiosity upon meeting me quickly turned into a desire to experiment upon me. To that end, I was put into a cart on a tail ramp, pushed down, and left to roll until one of them was able to catch up and rescue me. I know this reference won't mean much to you, but they reminded me of the Three Stooges. Poor girls can't do anything right, and they always manage to screw up more extravagantly when they're dealing with someone else. In this case, I was someone else, and I was dumb enough to send that cart 3 times, and only once did they manage to catch up before I hit a rock and tumbled out.
Foes will be foes, I suppose. It's somewhat cute that you are helping them out, though. Twilight Sparkle doesn't have you performing errands all day.
Thankfully, no. I'm usually left with free time. Unless she asks me for help.
The incident with the fillies was one of your mentioned encounters. What of the other?
I had to ride bareback on a rampaging and flying mare as she did her best to dislodge me with all her might.
That also warrants more explanation, I believe.
I don't know how much you know about Twilight's friends. In every group, there's at least one prankster, and Rainbow Dash is the one in that group. She took it upon herself to lift me up and try to drop me in a pond for a perceived slight upon her. I wasn't expecting to be dropped, so I managed to barely catch myself on one of her legs and pull myself up. She tried to dislodge me, it didn't work, and I finally managed to talk some sense into her long enough to get me on the ground. Then she lost that sense and decided that it would be awesome to have a sky rodeo, with me as the main star.
A sky rodeo? Who would be participating, and what would be the rules?
I don't know, and the only rule I'm concerned about is the one that involves saving the human before he falls to his death.
You actually agree to it? I'm surprised. You seem like you might have more sense than that.
I agreed to it under a condition that she could get enough Pegasi interested in it. I rather doubt that she'll be able to, thank God. Most of them probably haven't seen a human and wouldn't want to be ridden by one if they had. Good riddance to that, too.
What? You didn't enjoy your time in the sky?
I might not be opposed to the idea of riding a Pegasus as they flew regularly, just from point A to point B, but trying to hold on as they kick and buck is a bit more than I'm interested in. Especially if I'm high enough up that I'm falling is deadly.
It sounds interesting to me.
Well, if you can ever find a spell that would turn you into a human, be my guest. Hey, maybe she'd even be cute as a human.
I meant for the Pegasus. It would be a fun test of skill.
You are not making me any happier than I agree to it, even if it was under such an improbable condition.
This would be the best way to get you exposed to more ponies, Navarone. They're unused to you now, but if they were to appear in a content such as this, their views would change. And I'm sure you'll survive, if Rainbow Dash manages to get the support. Surely I or your sister can find a spell that would, if nothing else, make you fall a lot slower.
A spell that was made to work on ponies, who have a bit more mass and a very different shape than me. I'll be risking a lot just letting Twilight revitalize me between rounds. I'm gonna ask her to experiment tomorrow with various aches and pains I have now.
If you want, I could try now.
If you heal me, I'll have to get new aches and pains for Twilight to experiment on before the actual event happens. Unless you're planning on showing up to see it and it can heal me there instead of Twilight.
And miss my favorite human get thrown about? I wouldn't miss that for the moon.
We were nearing the fountain. I sat on the edge and told her to try if she wanted. She smiled and lowered her horn to touch lightly on my arm. A very concentrated black orb pulsed out of the tip of her horn and into my arm. Suddenly, all my muscles froze up for an instant. With my eyes seeing white, when I was able to see and feel again, I found myself thrown against a statue in the fountain, smoking lightly. My entire skin felt like it was on fire. I opened my mouth to scream, but the burning sensation left as soon as it came, and instead let out a discontented warble. I noticed that, at the very least, all the pain was gone.
What did you do?
I managed to stammer.
I healed all your physical impurities, she told me.
I checked my body all over. I was missing the small collection of scars I had picked up in my life. They were nothing big, just accidents and a surgery, but I liked to occasionally lie about how I got them. I also noticed that I was missing the occasional roomy cough that I had spent all my life with.
I don't know why it hit you so hard,
she continued.
You must have had a lot more wrong with you than just aches and pains.
I continued checking over my body. All the missing skin around my fingers was back, just a nervous tick I have, picking at it. The slight arthritis I picked up due to my genetics appeared to be gone, as my habitual knee ache was gone. My nose was no longer half clogged. I couldn't even feel the phlegm that was constantly at the back of my throat. As she said, I appeared to have been fixed of each and every physical problem. When I was able to get over the shock and see that she was still looking at me concerned, I managed to flash a weak grin. Don't worry about me. Just trying to sort out what you actually did to me. Trust me when I say it's a lot more than you know.
Magic is a wonderful thing.
I didn't answer. Instead, I tried to get to my legs and I managed a shaky stance. I picked my way off the frozen fountain and got my feet back to the dirt. Before she could say anything else, I hugged the princess around her neck. Holy shit, she's really soft. Her flowing hair was like silk and her wings were like velvet. I could tell she wasn't expecting a hug. When I let her go, she still had a look of surprise in her face and her wings were flared. You removed pains I've had for so long that I didn't even notice them anymore. I figured that was justified. I told her.
How do you stop noticing pain?
She asked, her wings slowly lowering. It's like breathing or blinking. It's just something that's always there and becomes normal for you. You don't notice that you're always blinking or always breathing until you stop to think about it. The pain I was carrying was constant, so I eventually phased it out. I had to actually concentrate to see if I could feel it anymore.
Humans are very, very odd.
How do you know that it isn't just me that's very, very odd?
Because I'm pretty sure if what I said wasn't true, you wouldn't have said that what you just did.
Odd is relative. I'm surprised there aren't plenty of ponies that are hiding pain like this as well. Applejack's grandmother is old and has a bad hip. You can't tell me she's not in some kind of pain because of that.
I've never really thought about it like that. I just know that I've never felt much physical pain. I never thought that it might actually be common.
You also don't spend much time around the regular ponies. If you want to rule your subjects, you need to know them. It would also help if they knew you more.
And you expect me to come to a festival designed around the fear of me, or rather, a nightmare moon.
When better? At her look, I tried explaining. Let the people see you as you are in contrast to what they fear. You've yet to cause any manner of harm, and you don't even look the same as Nightmare Moon anymore. Though, admittedly, I could barely see Luna in the weak light, and I never see Nightmare Moon. Though the reason I knew is because Twilight mentioned it in her ramblings about the festival. Hell, did you just tell me that I should do the stupid Sky Radio thing for the same reason?
As I said, Navarone, I will think on it.
She reared her wings again, and yet again I stopped her. You know, you didn't tell me anything about your day, or rather, your night, or when you're practicing talking. She lowered her wings and said somewhat coolly,
You are correct. I did not.
Friendship is a give and take. You don't have to tell me anything, of course, but I will listen if you want to. She looked at me for half a minute and finally said,
I will answer a question or two.
Who have you practicing talking with? As a side note that's relevant to the point at hand, ponies are truly terrible liars. Every one of them I have seen tell a lie, the very small number of them, has so many tells that you know automatically when one is lying. And the funny thing, not a single one of them notices. A pony could lie to another pony all day long, and unless the one getting lied can obviously tell the other pony is lying by looking at evidence, they always believe each other. I have abused the hell out of this. Anyway, I just put there to explain how I immediately knew Luna was lying when she said, my other friends. You don't have to lie to me. Mind, you also don't have to tell me the truth. I won't judge you either way. She sighed.
My servants.
I nodded slowly. Come by on the festival, princess. We'll find you some ponies to talk to. I think she smiled. I knew she flew off. There we go. Dang, we were so close to the 20-minute mark, but the next section of this is another whole day of content, and I didn't want to cut that off halfway. So, when we get there, and I'm not going to leave this fic for 3 weeks like I did last time, that's my bad, but I also won't leave are my wonderful Patreons. Thank you, my Tier 1 Patreons, Squall Windfeather, Rain Flicker, Starlight Blaze, Dreamless Portal, Thine Tiny Equine, and Stew Hacks. My Tier 2 Patreons, Chase and the Master, Sword Brother and Mordred, Solus, HKH4 aka Texture, and the Animated Ghost. And of course, a large thank you to Silent Titan and the requester of this fic. I hope you guys have enjoyed this
has been Firehearth. Have a wonderful day.